from all of this strife and commotion. Like a ship out over the ocean. Bless all my troubled brothers as they travel on the King's highway. Bless my kin, my friends, and all of the others. Bring us all to the light of day.
Down the shore, to the safe country, from the high mountain to the shining sea. I want to tell the youth
of the weeping country, yeah. Brother, you can stay here in the valley. There's room for you with me.
Sunrise morning, I'm gonna tell your friend. Sunrise morning, I'm gonna tell your
Institute in Advanced Studies, sponsored by Mark McCleary Ministries. I am your host, Dr. Mark A. McCleary, and I am peacock proud to welcome you to Renew the World with God's Word. I am the founder and president of Mark McCleary Ministries, www.3mmm.org. My vision, mission, and objective is to be recognized as an impactful practitioner of Bible-based education, human services, and resources that empower men, women, boys, and girls for living an abundant life. This program is a weekly interactive and mechanical handling of significant Bible passages. It is designed for adult and interested students of biblical learning. I am gifted and skilled in teaching and preaching God's Word. I can decipher and tell its story. I am trained to train whosoever wants to discover, live, and share God's Word in a world that needs true spiritual renewal. I am your virtual teacher, pastor, and mentor. For God's glory, your edification, and the devil's horrification. Let us pray to begin.
Amen. Good evening, everybody. It's that time again. It's that time when we get together on Tuesday night. And the Lord has blessed us to come full circle. Glad to be, and thank you for letting me into your living room to just participate a little bit. And let's share the word of God as we always do at this time every Tuesday night at 7 o'clock. Now we're going to be a little bit truncated because Facebook has said that they ain't said nothing to me, but it was brought to my attention when I was getting this production together, as I always do. And it said that Facebook had made some modifications and limitations. So until they release that, we're going to focus primarily on YouTube or LinkedIn. But glad to see all of you this evening, and God bless you. And yes, Sister Bolden, I know you're going to always keep us up to date what happened at the Key Bridge here in the Maryland area. There was some loss of life. I'm sure at least five of those folk who I think they said five, if it was more, I know they had pulled out about 20 or two. Folk out of the water. And so if they were about 20, and I haven't heard any reports of any further, probably fell up under that weight, hit the weight or whatever. It's those things happen. We don't play it off. We're not frivolous about it. But, you know, we used to pray, Lord, bless us from danger seen and unseen. So we never know the unexpected. So we pray for their families. And certainly we'll have that. Yeah, we'll talk about that a little bit more, but glad to be in the service. Good to see you, Sister Hayes. Bless your heart. I know you about fully recovered. Sister Smith, Sister Phillips. Yeah. I don't know, Sister, you know, Sister Daphne, you ask some questions sometime. I said, you all sit down, take an exhale and wonder. I don't know how, word I hear is that it may have been mechanical failure. In fact, someone reported that the lights were flickering before it even hit the stanchion, and then they lost power, so he couldn't steer it. That's why they had, I tell you, there's so many variables to life. You know, you think about all the drug mess that goes on, the drug testing of sports folk. How about how many times we fly? And what about the air traffic controller? If he had a bad night, or if he was doing something he ought not to be doing, or she was doing, and planes have taken off, the Lord blesses us. We put our hands in the hand of the Lord. Sister Davis, oh, my Lord, bless our heart. Glad to see you, Sister Davis. Sister Davis had open heart surgery a few weeks ago, but she ain't missed our power, I don't think. Maybe 1 week she may have, but glad to see you. Bless your heart. Well, I hope you got your pen, paper. We're going to annotate. We've done 3 weeks on the voices of these 12 Hebrew prophets. We did Amos. We did Hosea. And tonight, we're going to do number 3. We're going to do Micah. Oh, this is going to be interesting. And then we'll give you the assignment. Those of you who want to get started, next week. But we're going to do Micah tonight. So pay close attention and write down the impressions you get. Then read the book. I know they call them minor prophets, but I think you learn that they are only minor because they don't have the same volume of information that Jeremiah, Isaiah, Ezekiel, even Daniel are considered major prophets because they have more content. But here's Micah, and here's the key text out of Micah, found in Micah 6:8. You're familiar with it. He hath showed thee, O man, what is good, and what doth the Lord require of thee, but to do justly, and to love mercy, and to walk humbly with thy God. Boy, that's a threefold platform for true religion. Do justly, love mercy, and to walk humbly with your God. Well, as we start off, Isaiah or Micah is a contemporary of Isaiah. And some of the material that you read in Micah, you'll read, particularly, I think it's, is it Isaiah 2 and Micah 4? It's almost verbatim. As contemporaries, it's sort of like Haggai and Zechariah, contemporaries who were trying to get the returning exiles to rebuild their society, and particularly the temple. Micah gives these three messages spoken principally to the cities. Yeah, so he was an urban preacher, the centers of national life, those who were exercising authority, the mayor, his cabinet, and all the resources why people flock to the cities. Those who were exercised, he denounced the false rulers, and what made them false was not because they went to church on a certain day. What made them false is that they didn't live up to their job description. You supposed to honor or respect the Constitution, not telling me that you can walk down the middle of the street, shoot somebody with impunity, or grab some female in a private area. Come on now. How in the world can you even entertain the possibility of somebody like that running for office? And Micah, who talks to the leadership in these cities, says you won. He basically said, you need to have God say to you, well done. And ladies and gentlemen, while we talk about Jesus being a carpenter and there's not a whole lot of data about it, I think the word is trying to let us know that you ought to be gainfully employed. You ought to have a suitable occupation that matches your gifts, and you ought to do whatever you can do with expertise, professionalism, on time. Come on now. And Micah is the one who also adds his voice to the other prophetic voices, and he's telling the real ruler is coming. Y'all don't want to act right, but the true ruler is coming. And so he speaks to this nation. He speaks to the cities. He speaks to their leaders. He speaks to the stakeholders and the gatekeepers, because they have a lot of responsibility. We often respond and follow our leaders. And if you're not, if you're not constant, I ain't talking about being critical. I'm talking about being constructively aware to assess, to evaluate. Then you understand what Paul is saying. Follow me as I follow Christ. That preposition is key. You don't just put your eggs in the basket of some man, some woman, or who has some charismatic person. He said, follow me as, which means you got to have your eye on Christ so that you can tell whether the leader is leading you right. Here's another scripture in Micah. Wherewith shall I come before the Lord, bow down myself before the high God? It's to that question that the key text that we read to open up our discussion tonight was a response. It lets us know that there are possible approaches to God. And in verse 8, he said, do justice. That's a social term. See, justice always implies that there's some other, and we need to find a balance of fairness. Mercy has to do with the fact that if you hadn't messed up, you wouldn't need mercy. You know, we need mercy because we are flawed individuals and we have a propensity to mess up. But like that commercial says, I've fallen and I can't get up. No, you won't get up. With the help of God, by the grace of God, get up, dust yourself off, learn why you got tripped up, and try not to repeat that. Here's another scripture out of Micah. Shall I come before him with burnt offerings, with the calves of a year old? Will the Lord be pleased with thousands of rams or with 10,000s of rivers of oil? In other words, here's a Jew. And he's sort of psychologically playing on their minds and saying, have you put all your eggs in religiosity, in the ceremonies, in the rituals, in arguing what day, whether you eating meat or not, drinking caffeine or not? You know, those things are important. They're nice for living in this world. But what's the bottom line? The Lord is saying, in the environment that I placed you, McCleary, you got to learn how to get along with other people. Do justice. Then you got to learn how to forgive people when they mess up, just like you want to be forgiven when you mess up. And you're going to mess up. And then he says, you need to learn how to walk humbly with your God, with your God. That means you need to learn how to be quiet, stop trying to tell God what to do, and learn how to receive his revelation. This is the way, walk ye in it. Here's another scripture out of Micah. Shall I give my firstborn for my transgression, the fruit of my body for the sin of my soul? This is what a lot of the surrounding heathen nations were doing. They thought that they give their children, that that's what their God required. And now Micah, in a hyperbolization fashion, says, come on, man, how are you going to satisfy God? How are you going to please God? Is it by your church attendance alone? Is it because you give out a lot of baskets, food baskets? Is it some other thing that we think, well, this is part of the checklist of religion? He says, here's the bottom line. Whether you go to church or not, do justice, love mercy, and to walk humbly with your God. Now, the question is, when we listen to these prophets, the real question is, we got to look in the mirror of their word. We got to ask ourselves, are we wearying the Lord, like Micah alludes to? Come on, hear the plaintive cry of a father's heart. And the Lord is basically said, what have I done that you treat me this way? And the whole nation in their variegated manner were reduced to individuals. And Micah is sort of saying, McCleary, you need to look in the mirror of God's revelation. Sister Vines, you need to look in the mirror. Not like what many of us do. We point the finger, well, the elder, he ain't no good. Or the pastor ain't doing right. Sister so-and-so, yeah. Why, you got three fingers pointing back at you and you spit busy with that pointer finger, tell them, well, they ain't right. They ain't right. And they might not be right. But the Lord is basically saying through Micah, all right, I got you. I'm going to deal with them because I'm going to deal the same way I'm dealing with you is how I'm going to deal with them. What about you? What is your situation? Can you pass the TSA assessment? And then he asked the question, what doth the Lord require of me? And the fact of the matter is, Micah is saying, God does have requirements. And then he says, he has showed thee. So we know, we've been exposed to the revelation. So I guess we got a little ecclesiastical or theological Alzheimer's. We know how to forget, especially when he now gone from preaching, as we say, he gone to meddling now. He gone up on in my business. Well, that's what it's going to take, because God got to get in our business to make sure we're right. He said, because Wide is the way that leads to destruction, and many, no, church folk included, preachers from the pulpit, he said, but straight is the gate, and narrow is the way that leads to, and few there be. God has not left man without a revelation of his requirement. He has showed thee the law and the prophets, the Torah, or the Pentateuch, the entire Bible from in Genesis to Amen in Revelation, constantly tells us about case studies to let us know that God has revealed what is required. And so we don't have to sit around like the lawyer and play games, tiddlywinks with the Lord. What does the Lord require? What do I need to return? Then the Lord tell you, and then you want to play, well, who is my neighbor? And we're going to play 20 questions with the Lord. The Lord responds to Micah, oh man. So he's talking to us as individuals. He's talking to us in our independence from anybody else. And he's also talking to us in our groups, in our church, in our religiosity. What doth the Lord require of you, Mark McCleary Ministries? What doth the Lord require of you, Dr. McCleary? What doth the Lord require of you, Mark Antonio McCleary, born January 20, 1951? Yeah, you can try to sit in the back. You can bend your head. You can wink, or you can close your eyes, put your ears in your, but inevitably, I remember that commercial, sooner or later, the white owl man, he gonna get you. Well, God is greater than the white owl man. The eyes of the Lord run to and fro, and God has not left us without a moral universe. He's going to hold us accountable. While we talk about mama, daddy, sisters, and brothers, peer pressure, whatever, God is going to say, I showed you. I told you through the Holy Ghost. I told you in your Bible study. When you studied that Sabbath school lesson, when you heard that preacher, I was revealing to you the rights and privileges, the requirements, for making it into heaven. God has never abdicated. He is still the creator. He is still the king. He is still the father. And Micah reinforces it. God is creator. His fundamental justness of his claim is what he requires. I made you. I designed you. And this is how I made. Just like every car, brand new car. Got owner's manual in there. This is how to maintain this car. Or you like this car? Well, if you really like this car, make sure you change the oil in sufficient time. Rotate them tires. If you got a timing chain, make sure you do whatever you got to do to make that human device work at optimum efficiency. See, we can make, but we can't create. We should inherently feel we had a right to expect from that which we created, but that ain't the case. We ain't create nothing. We certainly ain't create ourselves. Then he asked this question, another verse in Micah. Shall the thing formed say to him that formed it, why didst that, that's Paul rather, why didst thou make me thus? And basically that's what Lucifer has been saying. Lord, I know you creator, but I think I got a better idea on you. He going to second guess God. He going to backseat God. And that's basically what, when Mother Eve, when she listened to him, she was basically saying, you know, you got to right thing about that, man. I think God really doesn't know everything he needs to know. I'm going to eat this fruit. And then Father Adam, he basically said, yeah, you know, you might be right. And ladies and gentlemen, when we honest with ourselves, we basically, when we get involved with persons, places, and things outside the will of God, we are basically saying, God really didn't know what he was doing. I got a better idea. And the sad thing about it is, when we see that our so-called better idea doesn't work, we go and repeat it. That ain't nothing but neurotic. a neurosis when you keep doing the same thing but expecting better results. Here's what the text says. It says he was more than creator. See, he put on another hat. He became the recreator or the redeemer. He created this world, and then just like the temptations, when we turned our back on him, he basically wrote the lyrics, I know you want to leave me, but I refuse to let you go. And the whole Old Testament, in fact, the entire Bible reminds us God is still the creator. He is the king. He is the lawgiver. And he has requirements for us to live healthy, happily, and holy. But as Father, now that's a revelation we need to understand. He is not only our provider, he is our caretaker. He is the one who watches over us. He doesn't blow a lot of trumpets about it, but he watches over us. And many of us could probably say, if it had not been for the Lord on my side, I know he may not come when you want him, but when you honestly, objectively look back over your life, you say, man, the Lord protected me from my foolishness, got me out of hot water before I got in it, saved me from being a victim of my own vices. God has been revealed, and Micah revisits or restates it or reemphasizes it, that God expresses his love in his fatherhood, in his watchfulness. The New Testament just causes us to use the term, he is the redeemer. He that Goel, that kinsman redeemer whose love never failed. He has a right as creator. He has a right as father to make requirements of us. That there's no human life. I've learned it. Now I know I fought and kicked against it, but I've learned that if you don't have law, if you don't have requirements, we will procrastinate. We will cut corners. Come on now. There's no successful, productive life that does not adhere to some kind of discipline or requirement. If you want a good job, then you're going to have to meet the requirements. If you want to go to school and pass the test, you're going to have to meet requirements. If you want to have a productive gathering of people, come from different backgrounds, but are willing to team up together and work together in what we call this church or that church, you're going to have requirements. No baby that's been born in this world can properly and productively grow and develop if they don't learn how to meet certain requirements at every level of life. You got to meet it in the home. Come on, that's what washing the dishes was about. Picking up your socks, your dirty clothes, taking out the trash. You were working in a domestic laboratory to get you ready to work along with other people, folks, some folk you ain't never met, but who will make all the difference in your life. You got to learn how to get along with folk. You got to do justice. See, God is creator. He's the father of every spirit. And with every human personality, there are to be found potentialities and possibilities. But if you don't learn how to buckle down and to batten down the hatch and learn how to get along with other folk, you're going to see that a lot of them are in prison. A lot of them are walking around the street where you live, talking to themselves about missed opportunities. God in Micah is simply saying, you rulers, you leaders, you individuals, if you want to be successful in life, you got to do justice. That's right. Be fair with other people. Be righteous. Be a person of integrity. Be a person who brings more productivity into the situation rather than problems. Come on now. The problem with the folk that Micah was talking about is that they had compromised. dealing with persons, places, and things. And so God sends Micah, contemporary to Isaiah, to basically tell them, call them back to the litmus test. He has showed thee, O man, what is good. And we need to hear. We need to be reminded of that. We need to be taken back to that old time religion to realize that it's good enough for us. The thing was written in the law, and the people need to reread the law. It's written in the Bible, and we need to read the Bible. Don't get ceremonial or ritualistic. Take a Sabbath school quarterly, and then at the end of 13 weeks, you give that Sabbath school quarterly back and look almost like it did 13 weeks ago when you first got it, because you ain't really studied it. You didn't open it up and look at those scriptures. You didn't ponder those things. The good has been revealed not in just the written law, but in the incarnation of Jesus Christ. That's the greatest revelation of justice, of mercy, and walking humbly with our God. There are those who do not know the ancient law, but they heard and they found Jesus. God comes to us. Just like someone said, you spell the church, you are the church. Too big God is to get around him. Too tall for me to get over him. Too deep for me to get under him. Too wide for me to get around. Look, you got to make sure, Mike is saying, you got to deal with these requirements. And ladies and gentlemen, they ain't got nothing to do with church membership. Y'all can fight all you want. And you can try to make yourself special if you want. I feel privileged. I'm glad the way I was nurtured and where I was brought up. But that ain't what saves me. There ain't but one thing that saves me, and that's the name of Jesus Christ. So, ladies and gentlemen, as we get ready to close, make sure you ponder this voice from Micah that uses the well-illed excuses and alibis that we give, trying to dilly-dally with God. No, he has showed thee, old man, what the Lord doth require of thee. Don't cry out on malignant, oh, I feel sick. Well, maybe we need to do analysis. What do you keep eating? What do you keep drinking? What are you doing? I know it could be the environment. Maybe you breathed it in. But be honest with yourself. Do a proper assessment. Do I have the kind of bad habits that contribute to my illness? Maybe I need to correct that, and I won't be getting sick as often as I have been. He has showed thee, hold on, you got to be just with yourself as well as someone else. The text gives us an interpretation of goodness. God is not requiring burnt offerings. He's not requiring calves of a year old or thousands of rams or 10,000 rivers of oil or the fruit of my body. None of these things have any value. Goodness is revealed in doing justice, loving mercy, to walk humbly with our God. See, if you walk humbly with God, you got to get along with other people because they're his children too. See, that's the supreme good, to walk humbly with your God. Isn't that something? When we look at Enoch, everybody living long there, and then they die. And then the Lord, I think, inserted this one episode to say, I know it looks kind of bleak. You still live long and you still die, but I'm going to find me somebody who'll do what? Walk with me. And the Bible says God took him one day because he learned to walk with God. Amos said in 3:3 of his book, you and God, can y'all too? Y'all different. My thought, Isaiah 55, my thoughts are not your thoughts. But if you keep walking with God, then you'll start talking like him, start thinking like him. See, goodness is first doing justice. Goodness is also about loving mercy. Goodness is about walking humbly with our God so that the decisions that we make are decisions that have lasting and principal foundation. Oh, come on, love, mercy. As I get ready to close, I was just 23, and I was speeding. I'm gonna shrink this story. I've told it before. I was shrinking out there in Kansas City, just taking up that assignment, and I was speeding. I was, but I didn't want to pay that ticket. So when he stopped me, I took my Bible and put it up in dashboard, hoping he might see it, ask me, "Are you a preacher?" and then give me a break. Yeah, well, he ain't said nothing like that. Took his time, finally came back, gave me his ticket. Wasn't really hospitable at all. Wasn't nasty or tactless, but he just gave me that. And just before I rolled that window up, he said to me these words, I can hear them now. "Next time, take that Bible and put it under the accelerator." Oh, y'all not listening to me? You know what that was? That was justice without mercy. Ladies and gentlemen, Micah is saying, if you really want to practice true religion, if you want to get beyond rhetoric and actually live a holy and righteous life to emulate God, he said, you got to do justice. Come on now. Do fair. Do unto others you haven't done unto you. You got to love mercy. See, mercy is only for people who done messed up. If you ain't messed up, you don't need no mercy. If I hadn't been caught or if I hadn't been speeding, I didn't need no mercy. But I got justice. And then he says, walk humbly with your God. When our Lord said, I am the light, we must remember that light can only condemn. That's right. Light throws a light on the darkness and says, you got to go. So, ladies and gentlemen, let the light of the world, who inspired Micah to give us a light of revelation, shine in your mind, in your heart, in your being, in your spirit, and let him dispel the darkness. Let him expel the excuses. Let him expel the filibustering. Let him expel anything that isn't like God, because he has showed thee, O man, what the Lord doth require of you, but to do justice, to love mercy, and to walk humbly with your God. Amen. What a word, what a word. I got to admit, I enjoy rehearsing and just summarizing the essence and the salient significance of these prophets. We've dealt with Amos and Hosea. Now tonight we dealt with Micah, and if you want to get a little head start, we're going to deal with Zephaniah. I hope you can find him, because we don't even talk about Zephaniah too much, so that should be interesting and enlightening as we look at another one of these 12 minor or Hebrew prophets as we pilgrimage in time one day to do traffic in eternity. Well, it's prayer time as we get ready to let you go. And I want to remember, I made mention of it earlier, the folk with the Key Bridge incident. And ladies and gentlemen, look, you understand what the Lord said. This is just the beginning of sorrow. Tomorrow is going to be something else. Just make sure that it ain't you on the 6 o'clock news, because you've been doing something across town at the No-Tell Motel and it got found out. No, make sure that you, like Micah, ask God, help me meet your requirements. Remember, my sister's still in St. Croix. I think she got a couple more weeks with that evangelism. She seemed to be doing well. Remember my daughter, Michelle, and all of you, like 3 John 2. I wish above all things that you would prosper and be in good health. Remember my son, he took his 4th treatment this past Monday. Haven't heard anything from my childhood friend, Vonzel. I have to check and find out. Earl Williams, one of my former members, had kidney surgery. He's out, he's recovering, so remember him. I keep getting folk who are asking for Bibles. So if any of you know where I can get Bibles, a good quality Bible, but doesn't, you know, something feasible that I can forward and then maybe ship, let me know, please. I appreciate it. Remember my mentees in Ghana? I think I told you that he's getting ready to do a big, oh no, here it is. Oh, major giveaway. Someone made a donation from the United States and they wanted to do it through Mark McCleary Ministry. And in Tanzania and in Florida, those folk that we are helping to develop and grow. And this is what my affiliate in Ghana sent me. This is certificate of incorporation. I hereby certify that Mark McCleary Ministries, LBG, is this day incorporated under the Companies Act 2019, and that the liability of its members is limited by guarantee. Given under my hand an official seal at Kumasi, Ghana, this 20th day. Lord, help me today. Man, I'm just following the cloud. So God bless you. I'm going to be sending out those of you who'd like to make an appeal or make a donation, because I'd like to make another donation to the folk in Tanzania and also in Ghana as we follow that master plan list that we developed. But thank you for that. Father in heaven, we thank you for the opportunity to pray. We thank you, Lord, that, you know, nothing in our hands we bring. Simply to your cross we cling. We need help. Things happen, mechanical failure. Lord, we need your assistance. Bless those families. I mean, went to work last night and didn't come back home. And many of us have had that kind of bad report. Lord, we ask that you be the balm in Gilead and use us or whoever to bring a word of hope and relief as they have to make adjustment to the loss of their loved one. Bless us here, Mark McCleary Ministries, to rehearse these Hebrew prophets. And may we use that to spring us to study your word however we need. And may we glean, not just be curious, satisfy our curiosity, but may we learn something. As your word said, faith cometh by hearing, hearing by the word of God. God bless you. See you tomorrow for morning dew. If you want to come by 6:30 on Altar Live, or we'll see you back here next week doing the same thing. Again, remember Facebook, you can try it. They may have rescinded that, but the word I got was that we're not on Facebook. In fact, let me just look and see. Yeah, there's nobody on Facebook. Only LinkedIn and YouTube. So if you spread the word or maybe send a word, Facebook may resend their limitation and we can be back on that platform. But until then, we're going to make the adjustment. We're going to do what we got to do, how we got to do it. In Jesus' name, God bless you. See you next week. Sister Daniel Young. All right. I got it. Thank you. Take care, folks. God bless you. See you next week or see you tomorrow on Morning Dew.